I'm going to talk about first the structure of hegemony and secondly about the implosion, the decline and collapse, which I think Ian referred to earlier on a little, and thirdly, resistance. The resistance is taking place now, and finally, I'm going to ask, what are we going to do about all these things? I think we look at US hegemony, it's based on four strengths or four foundations. One is, of course, its overwhelming military power, and two is, of course, economic dominance, technological innovation, and external cultural heritage. And among these four, I would say that the economic dominance and the cultural factor play very significant roles in ensuring the continuance of this hegemony. And one can say that the economic factor is now actually under assault from various sources. Now, let me just take you to, you know, the arch imperialist, Zbigniew Brzezinski. I don't know whether I'm spelling his name, I'm pronouncing his name correctly, and I'm not ashamed that I'm not pronouncing it correctly. I think we have distributed a paper here, and he's not shy, or he's not, you know, he's ashamed about the fact that the Americans want to impose their hegemony on the rest of the world. He's very frank about it, and he talks about the way in which it should be done. And it's interesting the role that he assigns to culture. For example, when he talked about British colonialism, he was trying to explain how a small nation, an island nation, with a small population, was able to control vast territories with, you know, hundreds of millions of people. And the thing he attributes to it is that the British were able to convince the colonized on the superiority of their civilization, of their culture. In other words, we internalized what actually they had, you know, they were saying about themselves. And this was a very important tool. And maybe I should read some relevant portions that he talks about it. In talking about British colonialism, he says that cultural superiority successfully asserted, not only asserted, but quietly conceded, had the effect of reducing the need to rely on large military forces to maintain the power of imperial center. Now, he also talks about how, unlike British colonialism or Dutch colonialism, which had to have a physical presence in the colonized countries, American colonialism, American imperialism did not need that, because it was able to do through, one is culture, the other is through a sort of international arrangement in which America was the dominant player, in fact, the only major player. Nobody will say no to its policies. He says, American global power is exercised through a global system of distinctly American design. And this was designed after the Second World War. You have the United Nations, you have the World Bank, you have the IMF, and then later you have the WTO, etc. These are international institutions which they used to control. And he goes on to say that all of the foregoing are reinforced by the massive but intangible impact of the American domination of global communications. I think probably Bon and Shoma will talk about it. Popular entertainment, mass culture, and by the potentially very tangible clout of America's technological edge and global military reach. Cultural domination has been an underappreciated facet of American global power. Whatever one may think of its aesthetic values, America's mass culture exercises a magnetic appeal, especially on the world's youth. Its attraction may be derived from the hedonistic quality of the lifestyle it projects, but its goal appeal is undeniable. American television programs and films account for about 3/4 of the global market. American popular music is equally dominant, while American fads, eating habits, and even clothing are increasingly imitated worldwide. The language of the internet is English, and an overwhelming proportion of the global computer chatter also originates from America, influencing the content of global conversation. Lastly, America has become a mecca for those, this is a very important point, lastly, America has become a mecca for those seeking advanced education, with approximately 500,000 foreign students flocking to the United States, with many of the ablest never returning home. Graduates from American universities are to be found in almost every cabinet on every continent. I think this is the reality that we are facing today, how culturally, intellectually, we are being dominated. But we need not fear this, I mean, we need to fight this domination, we need to fight this hegemony, we need to challenge this hegemony. But I don't think we need to feel depressed about the situation. I think there are two factors that are contributing to bringing about an end to this hegemony. One is, of course, an internal factor, a decline, an approaching collapse within the US itself. And secondly, is the challenge mounted by people who are being dominated, who have been colonized. And these two are very important factors that we have to bear in mind. We don't have to feel depressed. We have to feel optimistic that people are standing up and fighting this hegemony. Now, if you talk about the state of the American society today, it's facing a very severe economic crisis. A crisis to which nobody can really predict when it's going to end and where it's going to end. I don't know why economists exist. I don't think they can, they only talk about the, describe the event, but they're unable to provide solutions to the problem. They analyze things, but there is no way they can suggest solutions to it. I think this has even been expressed by many Western leaders themselves. We just take one example, the toxic debts. The IMF itself has estimated that in US alone, the loss will be $3 trillion US and $1 trillion in Europe and Asia. But then the Asian Development Bank, in a report, this is what it reads. A report claims that $50 trillion worth of financial assets have been wiped out in 2008, according to a report released Monday by the Asian Development Bank. The report also unveiled how Asia was hit hardest with a financial loss of $9.6 trillion, probably Japan and other countries, or what is just over 1 year's worth of gross domestic product. Now, there's the financial crisis. The whole financial system is in a mess in the United States. And it's not only going to affect the United States, it's going to affect all those countries who are linked so closely to the UN and the United States economic system itself. Now, secondly, the housing crisis. If you talk about the housing crisis in America, you know, they were talking about the bubble, the housing bubble years ago. Suddenly, the bubble has burst. And it has been said, it's been reported in the CBS that in the past 2 years, the housing market has lost an estimated $4.9 trillion, as 59 million homes have declined in value. Nearly one in four house owners, 10.7 million households nationwide, are underwater on their mortgages. They owe more than their home is now worth. Then if you look at the economic growth, they were predicting, like, you know, they were pumping billions of dollars into the financial sector, trying to revive the economy. Now it doesn't seem to be working. It is coming to an end, this whole priming the economy. Now they were estimating like over 3% growth. The growth has come down to 2.5%. Similarly, the consumption has declined to 1.6% from 1.9%. And you know that the US economy, the GDP, 70% of it depends on consumption. So if there is a fall in consumption, it's going to have a very serious crisis. Then there is growing unemployment. I think about 15 million probably. This is an underestimate, it has been said. Now, in addition to that, there are people who are underemployed. The so-called underemployment rate, which includes part-time workers who prefer a full-time position and people who want work but have given up looking, rose to 17.3% in December from 17.2% before. Now, in addition to all these, then you have the problem of deficits. The trade deficit in 2009 was 380 billion. The budget deficit in 2010 was 1.75 trillion. It is 13% of the GDP, US GDP. This excludes the $640 billion that have been given to defense, for defense purposes, and the cost of the occupation of Iraq and Afghanistan. Now, what is the cost of it? You know, it has a huge military presence, and this is one way in which it can intimidate and bully other nations. What is the cost of this huge military presence throughout the world? I mean, every part of the world, there are bases or some defense facilities, what they call defense facilities. It has 900 facilities in 46 countries, 190,000 troops overseas with 115,000 civilian employees. It spends $250 billion per year to maintain this base military presence, bases and military presence, $250 billion. Now, as a result of this, the public debt has been going up. In 2008, the public debt was 5.8 trillion. Now, according to the Boston Globe, let me just read from the Boston Globe, Congress raised the federal debt limits this month by this was reported in February 23, 2010. Congress raised the federal debt limits this month by 1.9 trillion to a record level of 14.3 trillion. Given the projected budget deficit for the next year, the gross public debt of the U.S. government will probably hit the 14.3 trillion limit by the end of 2010. The huge expansion of public debt is not just an abstract concern of economists. It is likely to hurt the practical situation of most American families and firms. So, then we go on to consumer debt. Between 2000 and 2007, U.S. households nearly doubled, that is in 7 years, they nearly doubled their outstanding debt to 13.8 trillion, an unprecedented amount in both nominal terms and as a ratio of liabilities to disposable income. It's 138%, the ratio of liabilities to disposable income. So they were spending more than earning, and there was no way they could do any saving. Now, this is a thing that is creating a serious crisis, and there is no way out. There is no way out at the moment for the U.S. economy out of this. Now, this itself, in fact, there have been so many articles in the internet that all you need is just one event, like what happened to the Soviet Union. You know, you needed Afghanistan for Soviet Union to collapse. So similarly, it may be Afghanistan that may trigger the collapse of the U.S. empire. I mean, inshallah, inshallah. Now, this is what I would say, the implosion. Implosion within the empire itself. Now, dealing with, you know, when we look at people under oppression, it does not mean they're just sitting and watching, you know, because it's the law of life. Oppression breeds resistance. People resist. People don't just accept. They do it in their own ways. You know, a farmer may do it in one way, a worker will do it in one way, an organization will do it in another way. Now, people are resisting U.S. hegemony in different parts of the world in different ways, from armed struggle to economic, cultural, and social boycotts. The purpose of this meeting should be to identify how we can fit into this global resistance and what role each of us can play to free the world from imperialist capitalist tyranny.